I'm not an alarmist. I've been doing this stuff for more than 30 years, and I have never believed, Steve, when I was a pastor for 20-some years, when I was doing, you know, the whole Trinity Broadcasting Networks, 700 Club, whatever, when I was doing all that, I have never thought that I was truly on the edge. Now, I would talk about prophetic signs, and this might be pointing to the coming of Christ, whatever, but personally, I never believed that we were really at the moment in which there could come a sudden acceleration. When I say sudden, I mean you go to sleep tonight, everything's cool and dandy, you wake up tomorrow, and there's 200 million Nephilim that are crawling over the earth, that this could happen so fast that you wake up one morning, and it's, you know, do you remember the morning when you woke up and 911 had happened?
Absolutely.
You take that, and a billion times more exotic, more frightening, more terrifying than that moment when you wake up and somebody says, oh my gosh, come here, look at television, something's happening, we don't know what it is, and people's hearts are going to fail them for fear. Now, the people who are in Christ, those people you were talking about earlier who are praying or interceding or intervening right now in what's going on at the CERN Collider, people like that have been sealed with the seal of God in their forehead. People like this are not going to be touched. And I want people to have courage that those who are in Christ, those who are true disciples of Christ, are going to be able, those are the overcomers. They're going to be able to overcome this phenomenon. But we have an entire world that, Steve, in one instant is going to be looking to us for answers. And
wow.
Unfortunately, you mentioned earlier the monopolistic churches, you know, I'm hoping that this series we're doing will also reach even some of those pastors who can somehow be stopped in their tracks and who will stop at least long enough to say, wait a minute, maybe we're entering into a period of time where we better start addressing these issues. You've seen these news reports, two of them in the last 10 days, saying that women at unprecedented numbers are leaving the Orthodox churches to join Wicca.
Yep.
What this says to me is not necessarily that these women are evil. It says to me that the church has no answers. They are not addressing the issues that are important to this generation. And as soon as they do, they'll be able to reach some of these people who are saying, forget it, I don't even know, your three-point sermon just isn't doing it for me.
And neither are your talks of golf metaphors, you know. I know pastors that seriously spend more time on the golf course than they do in seeking the face of the Lord.
Well, listen, Steve, early in this series, we were talking about the UFOs, but we also made the point, and we barely went there, and I think we ran out of time, actually, on this the last time, that this deception is not going to come just in the air. And people who perhaps might want to create a metaphor to, you know, today's contemporary approach to conducting war, or for that matter, what's been happening, you know, within the country for the last few decades. The war, when it is strategized correctly, happens in the air, on the land, and in the sea.
And under the earth.
Well, in the spiritual sense, it also happens under the earth. And Steve, hopefully most people are aware of the history of the giants.
I want you to get right into your newest finding on the Book of Enoch. Is this a good time to go there?
Yes, let's go there.
Okay.
The giants walked upon earth, and how that various ancient texts tell us about the watchers, these 200 very powerful angels who left their plane of existence, and they came down to the earth in the days of Jared, and they took women and animals through which they produced this unearthly offspring called Nephilim or Nephilim, the giants, and how that eventually that sin against God's divine order led to the judgment of the flood. Some people may also be aware that Enoch, an ancient prophet whose books are quoted in the Bible, in fact, whose books were once part of the Bible, but that's another show, how that Enoch's books provide great detail about the history and activity involving the sin of these watchers and their offspring, the giants, what they did, why they did it, And lastly, there are a few out there, I would suppose, who have paid close enough attention to the records, who also know that when the watchers and the giants were judged at the time of the flood, according to Enoch, at the time of the flood, that they were placed inside the hills and mountains of the earth. That's what Enoch says. They were buried beneath the hills and the mountains of the earth until, he says, the day that they are judged. But the interesting point is he also talks about others who will be released for a moment in time, at a specific time, who are going to be used for judgment. So now, on the idea that the watchers and the giants are inside the earth right now, for those who are listening. First of all, Enoch says specifically that Raphael, who was one of the, is a name he gave to one of the angels of God, that he put the fallen angel Azazel, you know him?
Yep.
Into chains. And, but he says he put him in a pit of sharp pointed stones in, the desert Dudael. Now, nobody knows where that desert is exactly, but that it does say in some text that there is a cave opening there. In fact, if you try to look this up like at, you know, Google or Yahoo or whatever, you'll run into many, many different texts talking about the cave of Dudael. Well, anyway, that's where Azazel was put. And so Raphael covered him there with darkness. In other words, he closed up the cave opening. He buried it with a bunch of rocks or whatever. And Enoch says that he is going to remain there until the day of judgment, when he is going to be thrown into a fiery pit of hell and of judgment, and the earth will be healed of the corruption that he and those who were with him contrived upon the earth. Now, one of the little interesting side notes, I won't spend any time on this, but the Jews, you know, they actually believe that Azazel, he remains there in that cave, but that he's actually a demon, you know, and he receives the scapegoat that's burdened with Israel's sin when it's pushed over the cliff. Did you know that?
Yep, I read that one time.
Anyway, following Azazel, being placed inside the earth, inside the cave there that's at Dudael, the others who participated with him and also their offspring, the Nephilim, Enoch says that they were bound. We talked the other day about the magic kasetot. He says that they're bound, they're pinned down under the hills of the earth. That's exactly what Enoch says. That's an exact quote. Under the hills of the earth. In fact, the rest of that verse says, where they will remain for 70 generations until the day of judgment, end quote. Now, Steve, this is where things start getting really interesting. And astonishingly, as many times as I had read this text, I never saw this until this week, and I emailed you and I said, Steve, I have found something astonishing, and I triple checked myself on this to make sure that I was correct. Many people mistakenly believe that all of the spirits of these giants went into everlasting chains of judgment, never to be released again, right?
Right.
Not only is that not what the Bible says, it's also not what the apocryphal pseudepigrapha says. For
right.
instance, in the book of Jubilees, chapter 10, verses 7 through 12, it talks about the malignant evil ones. These are the spirits. If you read the whole text, this is very clear.
Sure, and those are the ones Paul's talking about in Ephesians 6, too.
That's exactly right. These are the spirits of the Nephilim who were destroyed in the flood. He says they were bound in the place of condemnation. Now, this is interesting to me. There is a place, and it is the place called condemnation. It's a specific place. It's a specific location. They were bound there. Then Jubilees goes on, but a tenth part of them are left, that they might be subject before Satan, listen, on earth. And now Jubilees goes on. These will be for corruption and leading astray men before Satan's judgment, end quote. That's